Welcome to the 22nd lecture in the course Optimization and Data Science. The topic is Lagrange multiplier rule for inequality constraints. So this is an extension of the rule that we had in the last lecture, where we studied this rule for equality constraints. And yeah, the structure is the same. So I will describe how this rule looks like for then combined equality and inequality constraints, and we will discuss the optimality system, which is also called Karasjok-Tucker system or KKT system, which then is a little bit different for the inequality constraints. We will also have the second order condition for constraint problems, now with equality and inequality constraints both. A further topic that I want to discuss is the interpretation of the Lagrange multipliers. By now they were just additional variables that were helpful to compute the solution or the points which satisfy the first order condition, but there's an interpretation behind them. And in the last section I want to give an example a method which is used in data science, this support vector machine, and this is a classification method. And yeah, it leads to a problem where we have inequality constraints. Yeah, so here we have the problem, and our optimization problem, we have our cost function, and we have two constraints. We have a vector-valued function h, which again describes the equality constraints, and we write it as h of x equals 0. And then we have another function here where we have the inequality constraints. This is now m-dimensional, and we write it in the form j, g of x less or equal to 0. And then we define the Lagrangian or Lagrange function in a similar way to the equality constraints. So we add here the lambda as a Lagrange multiplier corresponding to the equality constraints, and we have additional Lagrange multipliers which are here in the vector mu, which are corresponding to the inequality constraint. So we just couple them, both constraints we couple to the cost function. And the lambda I and mu j are called the Lagrange multipliers corresponding to these constraints. So there is no difference in the definition of the Lagrange multiplier. So the inequality constraints are just added in the same way as the equality constraints. The rule now, the Lagrange multiplier rule, on the first glance also looks similar, because we have again this sum here, we have the gradient of f, we have the lambda I multiplied with the gradients of the constraint function here for the equality constraints, and we have the same thing for the Lagrange multipliers and the gradients of the inequality constraints, and we have here an equality equal to 0. The main differences are the red things here. We have now a sign condition on the Lagrange multiplier. So the theorem says that there exists non-negative Lagrange multipliers corresponding to the inequality constraints. And we have a further condition here, which is the scalar product of the Lagrange multipliers corresponding to the inequality constraints times the function of the describing the inequality constraint. So this is scalar product equal to 0 here, and this is called a complementarity condition. We will discuss this in a second. And the definition, we have had this definition already, that a point is called active, or the constraint is called active at this point if we have equality for the inequality constraints. So the constraint is called active, and this depends on a point. And the definition of a regular point is similar. So a point is called regular if the following set is linear independent, the gradients of the equality constraints and the gradient of the active inequality constraints. So this is a necessary condition here, or one necessary condition. And again, as in the case for the equality constraints, there are other conditions, other constraint qualifications that can be used. But here we will concentrate on this, which is the mostly used one, so that we need a regular point. And we discussed the importance already in the last lecture with an example for the equality constraint. Okay, so what we have now, and this is called the Karosh-Kuntaka or KKT system, this is an optimality system. So we again, we have additionally here these terms with the gradients of the inequality constraints, we have the constraints themselves, and we have this complementarity condition. If we look a little bit more in detail to this complementarity condition, we see this in combination with the sign condition of the Lagrange multipliers mu, because they are non-negative. And since we also have the condition that these g of x are have only non-positive values for an admissible point, so a point that satisfies this system and lies in the admissible set, we know now if we look at this scalar product here, which is written explicitly here, so it's a product of mu j and gj of x, so we have here terms with non-negative which are non-negative, and here we have terms which are non-positive. So here we have a positive sign, here we have a negative sign, and so all these terms here, every term in the sum has a negative sign or is zero, and so we have a sum of terms which have all the same sign. And if a sum of terms which have all a negative sign is equal to zero, then every term has to be zero. So this is the important point now here. So the complementarity condition means that every of these terms here under the sum is zero. And this means that we can now have a property with for every Lagrange multiplier and the corresponding constraint at the point x. Because we know, since all these products here have to be zero, we know if the mu j is positive, then the constraint has to be active. Otherwise, this would not be zero. And in the other case, if the constraint is not active, then the mu is equal to zero. So this means, if we split this system, or this equality here, inequality and this equality, if you and look for the constraints which are inactive, we have here a strict negative sign or strictly lower zero for the inactive constraints. But for these constraints, we can omit here the gradient terms because the mu is zero. For the other ones, for the active constraints, we have to take in the sum the values here of mu and the gradient, but then we have equality here in this last line. So we can omit the inactive constraints and corresponding Lagrange multiplier in this line here, and we then have a system where we have equality everywhere. If we just consider the active constraints, we have additionally, of course, that this has to be satisfied. So this is something we can learn, or we can see from this complementarity condition, taking into account that we know something about the sign of these two terms, or the sign of these two vectors, where we take here the scalar product. Yeah, exactly, this is what I just said. The complementarity condition, we can now use also symbols here, which we will use later on in the algorithm. So we have active constraints and we have indices where they are depending on the point x, on the variable x, we have indices where the constraints are active here, and we have indices where we know that the constraints are inactive, and the mu then has to be zero. Of course, it can happen that both is the case, so mu is zero and g is also zero, gj. But if we write the KKT system now with the inactive constraints omitted here in the first equation, we would get something like this. And we split it up here in these two parts. So this is what I meant. We have a system now here where we have only equalities. And here we have a system, or a part of the system of inequality constraints, where they are strictly satisfied. So with respect to these constraints, the points don't lie on the boundary. If we look at the example of the last lecture, where we had this rectangle with maximal area, now we and then we said we have a given parameter equal to c, that was what we had last time, we can easily modify this and say, okay, same problem, but we say the parameter should be less or equal c. So basically it's clear that we get that we will take the maximum parameter, but formally we can write down this problem as a problem with inequality constraint now. To just put this here, and then I have this form that I need in my general formulation, that g of x is less equal to zero. I have just one constraint, and again I have here the cost function. I can write down the Lagrange function. It looks the same now, just replace lambda by mu, but it doesn't matter. And the KKT system now looks like this here, and I get the complementarity condition, which is now just a product of these two terms. And if I compute this, so we already did this here, we computed the gradient where we used a lambda, and we also have, yeah, the constraint is written down again, and we can write this is also the same thing. But now you can see the difference. So in the last example where we treated this as an equality constraint problem, we just had equalities here, and we can just, it was then a linear system in this easy case, and we can compute, or we could compute, the solution. Now we have an inequality, a direct computation is now here not possible just looking at the system, and this in general would be the case. Because in general this would be much more complicated for a realistic problem. So we have an inequality here because of our inequality constraint. In this example we had, and this is what we also did in the last lecture, we find out that x1, x2 equals 2 mu, and for the from the complementarity condition we can also see if mu is equal to zero and all three values are zero if the constraint is inactive. So if mu is zero, so let's go again back here, if the constraint is inactive, we know that mu is zero. Yeah, so now we obtain the KKT system. The first two equations are the same as in the last lecture, with just lambda replaced by mu. This is this equation. Then we have the inequality constraint and the complementarity condition. Now we have here an inequality, so in general we cannot directly solve this system. And this is quite an easy version because it's a very easy problem, but in general we have here nonlinear functions. But the main point is we have an inequality now. In this case, we can, in the same way as in the last lecture, deduce from the first two equations that x1 and x2 equals 2 mu. And now we can exploit the complementarity condition. And we know if the constraint is inactive, so if here is a strict lower sign, then we get that the Lagrange multiplier will be zero, and this means, because of this here, that also x1, x2 equal to zero. So a non-zero solution we only get if the constraint is active. So this means if this equation is true, and then we can use here our representation of x1, x2 and obtain the results that we already had in the case for the equality constraint. So this is the same case, we just applied, we reformulated the problem a little bit, because I said I want here a lower equal c, but it's obvious that the best choice is of course to use the biggest parameter that is possible or that is admissible. But we used for the solution a little bit different technique, because we used here the complementarity condition. And already last time we showed that this the gradients are linear independent. So what we have to prove is that the gradients here of this of the constraints, and we only have one constraint, are linear independent, which means if we have just one gradient, it should not be equal to zero, and we only have to study the active constraints. But as we saw here in the optimal solution, the constraint is active, and so we study the same gradient that we studied last time, and it is constant. You can see it was a gradient was 2, the gradient of the constraint. Yeah, if we take a slightly more complicated example, where I have no quadratic terms and I have here a set, so two intervals in both direction, I have one interval, so I have what's called a box constraint or simple bounds on the parameters, I can rewrite this, or I have to rewrite this, into four inequality constraints like this. So this, every interval for one dimension or one coordinate direction gives two inequalities, and then I can compute the gradients, and we can see that these are constant here, but obviously they are not, all four are not linear independent, but this is obviously also because a point cannot be cannot have both of these constraints active. So the point is either at the value 2 here or 3, so there's only one of these two constraints which can be active, and the same for 0, 1 for these two. So only two of the constraints can be active, and if you look at them, for example, on these two, or on this combination, or the other combination, or this combination, they are all linear independent. So if we, all the points where the inequality constraints are active, they satisfy the regularity condition. And now we can compute the KKT system, and yeah, basically it looks similar to the one we had before, but now we have four Lagrange multipliers here, add them, and this leads to this system. And again, we have inequalities, so a direct solution is also not possible, because we have inequalities, and then we have the complementarity condition. So we need, in general, we can say we need a different approach to, or algorithm, to solve these kind of problems. And the idea is that we will study in the next lecture. The idea is to always to look at active and inactive constraints, or take advantage of this interpretation of the complementarity condition. Before we do this, I want to give two theoretical inputs on the Lagrange multipliers for inequality constraints. First one is the second order condition, and this is a similar one than in the last lecture for pure equality constraints. So we need twice a continuously differentiable function. We need a regular point. We need points that, so x star lambda mu satisfy the KKT system, and we need the Hessian matrix to put positive definite as an assumption here. And now the condition, this is the same as the last one, in the last lecture, where we had here that we only consider vectors which are perpendicular to all the gradients of the equality constraints, and we also need the same thing for the inequality constraints, which are active and where the Lagrange multiplier is greater than zero. And then we have that x star is a strict local minimizer. So these are the assumptions that we need to show that we have a strict local minimizer. We had an example in the last lecture where this was done for the equality constraints. The second theoretical input is the interpretation of Lagrange multipliers. So as I said, up to now there were just unknowns that we use to compute the solution if we can solve the optimality system or the KKT system, but the multipliers have a meaning, and they have the meaning of the sensitivity. So if we have the second order sufficient condition be satisfied, and then we consider a perturbed problem, and what is perturbed is the constraints are perturbed. So in our normal problem, standard problem constraints, we had here two zeros, delta zero, epsilon zero. This was our system where we have a solution now if the second order sufficient condition is satisfied. But now we consider a slightly perturbed problem. So we consider delta here, delta is a vector because g is a vector, epsilon is a vector because h is a vector. So we consider now the solutions, the minimizers of the perturbed problem. So the idea is we make a small change in the constraint. And then the multipliers that we have, lambda and mu, they give us the derivative with respect to these parameters. So if we slightly change epsilon going from zero to, let's say, a positive value, then we will change, of course, the minimizer of the problem. If we only do a slight change, then we have a continuous dependency. And also, as we can see here, a differentiable dependency of the cost function value. And here there's a minus sign in both things. So for mu, the same thing when we vary the constraint here, or we disturb or perturb the inequality constraint here. And the idea is very simple, and this is the reason why this is important. Let's say you have some capacity of production planning or whatever, which is given here, which is in the cost function. And so because we write the cost function here always g equal or less equal zero. So this means if I now slightly increase the value here such that the zero becomes a delta, which in the production planning, for example, would say I have more capacity, then I can see how this will affect the cost function. The Lagrange multiplier tells me if it makes sense to change these constraints a little bit, and the same for the equality constraint. And these are vectors, so you can also see this in the components of the function. Because here this is a vector, lambda is a vector, so you can look at the jth component of the vector mu and can see which constraint may be changed to achieve a given reduction in f. And this is very important information. We can see this in our example, in the very simple example, because here we already computed everything. We had x star and we had lambda or mu, but I take now the lambda value, so the equality constraint case. This is the value of our cost function. So if we now perturb the problem, so we put here an epsilon, which means I increase C. If I put the epsilon on the other side and get again h equal to 0, it's the same thing as I would increase C. So I increase the parameter. How would this affect my cost function? And of course, it is clear if I have a higher, bigger parameter, I will get a bigger area in my rectangle. And this is what this theorem about the sensitivity says. The solution of the perturbed problem is very easy, but I can just replace C by C plus epsilon. So the solution, the value of the cost function would be like this. The sensitivity now, I can compute the derivative of the cost function value depending on epsilon with respect to epsilon. So I compute the derivative of this, which is very easy, gives me this. And if I evaluate this at the point epsilon equal to 0, I get C over 8, which is lambda. And here's the negative sign, which is stated in the theorem, which cancels out with this. So this was the lambda that we computed before. Lambda gives me the sensitivity. So lambda says the derivative of the cost function with respect to a change in the equality constraint, and here in this example a change in the parameter. So this of course is a very simple example, but if the assumptions are satisfied, this can be used, and this is a very important information. In the last section of this lecture, I want to give an example which is coming from data science. It's the method support vector machine. It's a classification method for the classification of data. And the reason why I have this in this lecture is that at the end this leads to an optimization problem with inequality constraints. So the problem is that we have data sets. So we have a data set which has m entries, and each of these is a vector in Rn. And we have two data sets, or the whole data set is separated into two classes. We have one data set belonging to the red class here, where we formulate this with the function. So the function value for this red points here for this data set is 1, and for the blue data set, or for the subset in the whole data, the blue ones here, the function is minus 1. And so these are considered as training data, so we know to which class each data vector here belongs, and we want to find a separating hyperplane here. And so in the 2D example is just a line. We want to find it which separates these two subsets of the data, and such that we can easily, if we get another new data vector, we can easily say, oh, it belongs to this class or it belongs to the other class. So we regard this ZJ as training data that we have. And so what we are looking for in higher dimension is a hyperplane here. And so we need a little bit geometry. And hyperplanes can be defined easy. If we have a hyperplane which is going through the origin, we just take a vector which is not zero, and all points which are perpendicular to this fixed vector A, they lie on a hyperplane going through the origin. And we can formulate this in mathematical terms, or as a formula, the scalar product is equal to zero, because the angle between vectors in the Euclidean space is defined by the scalar product. And if here a right angle, then we have that the scalar product is zero. So we can define an hyperplane going through the origin, just saying these are all points in Rn which satisfy that A transpose x equal to zero. So the x that we chosen defines the direction of the hyperplane. And of course it should not be zero, because then every vector in Rn would satisfy this equation. So this is an hyperplane going through the origin. If we here take another vector like this, we would turn the hyperplane, but it's always going through the origin. So what we need is a generalization. So we need hyperplanes going to an arbitrary point, which are shifted hyperplanes. And for this purpose, we just take a number, b in R, so a real valued number. And so all points satisfying that this A transpose X is not equal to 0, but is equal to a general real number, lie on a shifted hyperplane. And so we can see it like this. Here we had our original hyperplane, and if we have add here some what's also called a bias, then we shift the hyperplane either to the one or the other direction. And the length of this shift is not exactly b, but it's b divided by the length of a. So and this we can see from looking at some geometrical basics. So we need to recall some definitions from geometry, and the first one is we see here in this visualization we have a vector A which is perpendicular to the hyperplane and defines the hyperplane, and then we take a vector X lying here on the hyperplane, then we see that we have here a right angle triangle, and then we know if we take the projection of X onto A, then this equals the length of x times the cosine. So if we would have a unit circle, so the length of x would be 1, this length is then just the cosine. And in the general case, so the projection of x on the vector A is the orthogonal projection, then is the length of x multiplied by the cosine. On the other hand, we have the definition of the cosine, or the definition of an angle between two vectors in the Euclidean space, and the cosine is defined by the scalar product of these two vectors divided by the norms of these two vectors. If we put this together, we find that the length of the projection of x onto A can always be written like this. So this is true for this point here, which lies on the hyperplane, but it's also true for general points. So for any point in the in Rn here, or in this example in R2, the length of the projection onto A is given by this quantity here, scalar product of A and X divided by the length of A. So by using this fact that the length of a projection of an arbitrary vector X onto A, we can now separate the points, because we know for the points on the hyperplane we have A transpose X equal to B. So the length of the projection is this term here. This is for the orange vector here, the point our vectors lying on the hyperplane. For points on one side of the hyperplane, this length of the projection is bigger than B divided by A norm. So we can also write this in this term here, just looking at A transpose X minus B, because here we have the same terms in the denominator. And the same is true, or with a different sign here, or with a different relation, is true for the other points on the other side of the hyperplane. Here the length of the projection is less than this length here, and so we can characterize these points by this. So given a B and an A, we have a way to describe which points lie on one side of the hyperplane and which lie on the other side. And so, but this then might, if we use now an A and B and find an A and B that such that this is satisfied, it might be that some points like lie very close to the hyperplane. So what we define is a kind of margin. So this is this delta. So what we want to have for the points with where f of x is plus 1, we want not just to have greater than 0 here for this term, we want to have greater equal this delta, and for the other one as well with the minus delta. And now we can see here, if we multiply the second inequality by minus 1, then we can write this in this term here. Because multiplying this by minus 1, so by f of x here, which is minus 1, we can write it in this general form for both cases. Here we have a f of x plus 1, so we can have just a 1 here. If we insert here minus 1, we get the here a minus times minus gives plus, and here we have the other relation. So we can write this, and this is our constraint. This is an inequality constraint. And yeah, where is the optimization problem? The optimization problem is, yeah, we have already found out that this is the distance of a point to the hyperplane. So the difference between these two terms, remember, on the hyperplane this was equal, and for the points not on the hyperplane there was a difference, and this difference gives the signed distance of a point. And here we have this term, the a is in the denominator, so this is a term depending on a and b and on the norm of a, and we have a fixed margin here that we defined already. If we write our constraint like this, so we have here greater equal delta, but if this is greater equal delta, the distance is still determined also by the length of the vector a. So if this a is very small, the length of a is very small, the distance to the hyperplane is getting bigger. So the separation is better if the length of a is small, and this is our cost function. And since we can also take here the squared of the norm, because then we have a differentiable function, because we don't have a square root, if we take the square of the norm, we take this as optimization problem, or this as cost function, and we get this optimization problem. We have the given data, and we know what f of zj is, then we want to minimize this quadratic cost function with respect to this linear inequality constraints. And our parameters are a and b. So, and we can see that it's obviously from the picture that the position of the separation line or hyperplane just depends on the vector which are closest to the hyperplane. And these are called the support vectors. So this is the reason where the name comes from. This is possible, or this works, this procedure, if the data are linear and separable. If they are not, there are additional tricks to do this, but this we won't study here in the lecture. So what we have an optimization problem looking like this, quadratic cost, linear inequality constraints. We rewrite the constraint in our form such that we have g is lower equal zero. We have m inequality constraints, and we can write down a Lagrangian, like we already did this for the inequality constraints. But now we can see that we need a solution algorithm for problems with inequality constraints. So for now, for this lecture, we have extended the Lagrange multiplier rule for problems with both equality and inequality constraints. We have basically the same form as for pure equality constraints, with two differences. Lagrange multipliers for the inequality constraints are non-negative, and we have a complementarity condition. We call this the KKT system. And yeah, the numerical solution is different because the optimality system includes now inequalities. And the complementarity condition might help to identify active and inactive inequality constraints, and it might also help to compute a solution, very simple examples directly, and it will also help to derive an optimization algorithm for this. And yeah, support vector machine was an example for this. So at the end we get an optimization problem with inequality constraint, and this is a method that is used for classification.